Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. In today's video, I'm coming back to the topic of wave energy. One thing that I've noticed in the last few months since I started paying attention is that wave energy is not at all like wind energy, which started out with a lot of variety, but has really narrowed down to a pretty standard design for the majority of situations. Wave energy converters, on the other hand, started out very diverse and continue to be pretty diverse. Why is there so much variety? Are there any design trends? Today, I'm talking with Florence Ungaro, who is a mechanical engineer at EMEC, the European Marine Energy Centre. I'm going to get her take on the issue.
Wave energy is very, very site-specific. I don't think we will converge to one type of technology, not go too big, too fast.
Can you tell me what EMEC, what EMEC does?
So EMEC, we have the test site. We help people testing on what we do because we are an accredited laboratory for ISO 17025. We provide a power performance assessment, which means we do the measurement of the electrical power, the power and the resource. So that means we instrument the sea, so we would measure the wave and calculate how much power we're in there, or we can also put down ADCP on the tidal site and measure the tidal current exactly at the location of the device. And then we can just do the ratio between the electrical power output and the power input from the sea, be it wave or tidal. We issue performance assessment to developers, which usually help them demonstrate that their device can produce electricity, and how good have they produced electricity, and that will help them go to investors to ask for the next round of funding to scale up or to go to commercial project.
And is that a normal thing to do? Would you say that most investors would require an independent verification?
It's very hard to compare technologies between each other because they're not really they have not really tested to exactly the same metrics. Let's say some have tested just after the generator, some just after the cable. Through our accreditation, we are allowed to do an accredited performance assessment according to the standard. That means that the way we would measure is following the standard and is exactly the same for everybody. That makes it very comparable. That adds a lot of trust in such reports.
Okay, so that is interesting. I've noticed that there's a lot of debate about the pros and cons of the various types of wave energy converters, and even a lot of mistrust in the claims that some wave energy companies are making about their technologies. So obviously there's a standard for measuring and reporting the power output of devices when they're tested in wave tanks. But when you get out in the ocean, things get a lot more complicated. I wanted to know whether we're able to compare the energy captured by different types of technologies in a standard way that we can trust.
ICTS 62600-100 or -101.
Okay, so there shouldn't be any...
Boring.
Yeah, I probably won't read it. But there shouldn't be any debate. If a company says that they have achieved, you know, this output and they've followed the standard, everyone should know what that means. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, exactly. So for wave, the power output, the way it's normalized and standardized is through a capture length matrix. When we measure the output from the wave device, we also have a wave measurement instrument that exactly measure what is the wave height and period. We would exactly know from the time series of the electrical power in which bin of wave height and period they were. So that's how you would populate this matrix. And then we just do a comparison between what power was in the sea and what power was given out by the device in this sea state. Okay. And that's how you represent the performance for wave device. It's calculated in kilowatt per meter of wave. The power output of the WEC is basically just power in kilowatt. When you want to do the ratio of that, you're left with a length dimension. So it's a bit like a percentage, to be fair. It's the way it is. At least everybody is talking the same language.
Yeah. And I guess it's like any other kind of energy. In the end, everyone cares about what's the cost of the energy. The efficiency
exactly.
isn't the most important thing when waves are free. Mm-hmm.
And you can see very interesting patterns of some wave device are, let's say, very narrow band. Mean they are very performant in some sea state, but if the wave period goes much higher or much lower, or the wave height is too small or too big, then they don't operate anymore.
Okay.
But maybe site it's relevant because those sites have a very consistent wave climate. Some devices are more broadband. They would work for much more variety of wave height or much wider variety of wave period. They would be quite, maybe less performant than the other one, but quite performant. So that would mean that from most of the year in places where they have a very varied wave climate, they would still be producing electricity. So it's all... wave energy is very, very site-specific.
Okay, so that's really interesting because that's a big difference to other kinds of... I mean, obviously, it matters how good the wind is where you put a wind turbine.
Yeah, you would have like type 1, 2, 3 classes of wind and wind turbines and water sites.
But it's and with solar as well. I mean, some places have more intense sunlight than others, but it sounds like wave is on a different level for...
It's like it moves two ways. So you have devices that would target maybe more monochromatic seas, that is sea that comes from one direction.
Mm-hmm.
You have wave technologies that would target wave like which we call them like spread seas, that is seas that is not very monochromatic, but you would have a swell coming from many directions and they will still be performant. Some will align with the main swell direction, just because they're moored on one side and then they would tend to drift with the drifting forces from the wave. Some just stay in place, or some are tension legs, so they are really just working with the heave movement of everything. It's really, really interesting.
One thing I've noticed is that there's such a huge variety of wave energy devices, both in the past, but I mean, it doesn't really look like it's narrowing down to everyone.
No.
No. And maybe this is the reason, because there isn't just one kind of wave energy. So how could you have one kind of wave energy converter?
No, yeah. Mm-mm. No, that's a really interesting bit about it, is like, I don't think we will converge to one type of technology. Like tidal tend to look a bit like wind turbines.
Yeah.
And water, be them floating or seabed mounted. But wave, I think you will... if it breaks through, it will still be different technologies cohabiting.
I'm interested to hear how the development process works. Say I had an idea for a new kind of wave energy converter. How would I go about commercializing it? Since Florence has worked with a bunch of different technologies through the development process, I asked her how this normally works, and what are the common sources of failure in wave energy converters. And also, whether we are seeing the same issues again and again as the older wave energy companies close down and new ones start up. Can they learn from earlier failures, or does progress start again new each time?
A developer must gradually show performance at smaller stages, and not only on the power performance. You need to show your scenarios for installation, maintenance, reliability, survivability of your device in high seas, not go too big too fast, but really gradual testing and seeing if this works at small scale, but does the scaling up will increase the cost much more or less, or a bottleneck technologically that needs to be looked at.
What kinds of devices do you think are going to be successful moving forward? Have you got some ideas about what's got potential?
What I see is that, especially in Europe, and I think in the US as well, we are all trying to, through standards, because of lesson learned from the previous testing, channel or give a lot of guidelines for the industry on how to develop step by step.
Okay.
And make everything reliable. And I think this has been taken on board by investors and laboratories and device developers mm-hmm. as well. So I can see that innovation and development is being more and more less chaotic. To be fair, if you are new to the field or investing companies or insurance don't really have anything to compare technology to anything else because it's usually one of its kind.
Okay, so thanks a lot, Florence, for sharing your experiences with us. I found it really helpful to get a perspective based on a large number of technologies that Florence has worked with. So I guess that's what gives her broad perspective. I thought it was interesting to hear how the field is maturing, how governments and regulatory bodies are stepping in to help make sure that lessons are getting learned by the industry as a whole. So even if an individual company fails, then the experiences they got, they don't need to stop when that particular technology doesn't continue. Also, the idea that wave energy converters may never converge to a single technology because there is no single wave type. That was a new idea for me. I had kind of considered that the diversity was a sign that wave energy is still immature, but I can see now that there could be a day when there were several different kinds of wave energy converter technologies that were mature and simply suited to different wave environments. If you've got any questions or other topics you're interested in about wave energy, then please leave them for me in the comments. I'll have a couple of other interviews coming up where I can cover them. So make sure to subscribe and turn on notifications to see when those come out. If you liked this video, then please support me by liking the video and sharing, and I'll see you in the next one.